That will be delivered by Divya ma'am. Over to you, ma'am.
Thank you so much for reminding me that my slides are not projecting over there and we haven't introduced me. Thank you so much for introducing me. So I was on the subject that the PPI have been proven for their efficacy and for their safety. And the proven the superb efficacy and the low toxicity really resulted into the first OTC drug in 2003. And it has contributed even to the overuse and even the misuse of this drug. So we clinicians also have a habit to prescribe PPIs or to our patient, to every of our patients for the longer term and even for the lifetime also. So let us see how long we can use this drug safely and how long is not too long. We all know that GERD or gastroesophageal reflux disease is one of the most common ailments we are coming across in our OPD. And PPI therapy is the mainstay pharmacological management of GERD. And although it is also true that approximately 40% of the patients, they are not relieved of their symptoms even after using PPI. And for this subgroup of patients, we should use the management strategies beyond PPI with other non-conventional therapies or even for surgical options for these kind of patients. So GERD can manifest as non-erosive reflux disease in 60 to 70% of the patients, as erosive esophagitis in 20 to 30% of the patients, and in approximately 6 to 10% of the patients, it may be as Barrett's esophagus. So coming to the management of GERD, this is a current algorithm for the, this is the current algorithm given by Indian Society of Gastroenterology Consensus Guidelines 2019. If the patient is having mild symptoms like heartburn or SAR regurgitation, the lifestyle modification can play a major role and can benefit the patient almost by 50%. And even if the patient is feeling the symptoms, the same symptoms on demand, H2 receptor antagonists or antacids can be given to these patients. And if there is no response, PPI once daily can be added to the prescription. And if they're in follow-up studies, the follow-up visits, the patient relieves of its symptoms, then for long-term management, on-demand therapy can be prescribed or the dose can be reduced. But if the patient is having no response to the initial PPI dose, then the dose can be increased or can be optimized. And if there is no relief, the PPI after the optimization of PPI dose, then diagnostic UGI endoscopy should be done to find out the severity of esophagitis. And if it is there, PPI should be continued twice daily for at least 8 weeks. And even if there is no response, then esophageal manometry should be done to localize LES and look for any alternative diagnosis. If the reflux is confirmed, then PPI should be continued. Surgical options can also be thought of, and other non-conventional therapies can also be prescribed to these patients. And another H2 receptor antagonist can be added at the night time for supine refluxes in these patients, and prokinetics can also be given to these patients. And if the reflux disease is unconfirmed and symptoms are there, then TCA or SSRI can be given to both of the patients if they have hypersensitivity reflux and if there is functional heartburn in these patients. So we should always assess every patient before starting proton pump inhibitor therapy if the patient is having a clear-cut indication for starting the therapy. These are some of the FDA-approved indications, like to treat gastroesophageal reflux disease, for healing of erosive esophagitis, in the maintenance treatment for healed erosive esophagitis, to treat gastric and duodenal ulcers, and as a prophylaxis for NSAID-induced ulcers, to treat Helicobacter pylori infections in combination with antibiotics, and for the management of pathologic hypersecretory conditions, including Zollinger-Ellison syndrome. So how long the PPI can be given in different subgroup of the patients? Can it be used for more than 8 weeks? Yes, there are indications for its use for more than 8 weeks in the patients who have prior GI bleed, in Barrett's esophagus, in the patients who have severe esophagitis of Los Angeles grade T. Ongoing NSAID use can also be an indication for long-term use of PPI with dual antiplatelet therapy with prior UGI bleed or with ongoing hypersecretory conditions. PPI can be used for longer than 8 weeks. So these are the common agents available till date. Omeprazole, esomeprazole, everyone of sitting here must be knowing. And these are the standard doses to start with in any of the patients with GRD. And we should always, always remember that after symptomatic relief, we have to reduce the dose to the maintenance dose. For omeprazole, it is 10 milligram. And the most commonly used drug is pantoprazole, rabeprazole. For the maintenance therapy, pantoprazole 20 milligrams should be used, and as in a standard dose, which it should be started with 40 milligrams. And rabeprazole to be reduced to 10 milligrams after an initial therapy with 20 milligrams of the dose. So now coming the question that when and how is it appropriate to prescribe a proton pump inhibitor? So to initiate the therapy, whenever we want to initiate therapy in any of the patients, it is really helpful to discuss with the patients that what will be the expected duration of the treatment, and the message should also be reinforced that the treatment will not continue indefinitely and we have to taper down the treatment. Sometimes we have to stop the treatment as well. This will make our job easier in further treating the patients. For most of the patients, it is appropriate to start with omeprazole 20 milligram once daily dose, and in very rarely in some of the patients, 40 milligram dose is required, a higher dose is required for any of the PPI. Starting treatment initially with omeprazole 30 milligram is really, really very rarely required in primary care setting. Over the time, and again, depending on the indication of the treatment, the PPI dose should be reduced, for example, of rabeprazole from 20 milligram to 10 milligram, and for omeprazole as well from 20 milligram to 10 milligram, or it may be changed to as needed dosing if inadequate control of symptoms is achieved in these patients. So these are the some of the risks associated with definitely with the long-term PPI use. Though these are proven to be comparatively safer drug and having a low toxicity, even then some of the adverse events are related with long-term use of PPI. Some are unrelated to acid inhibitions and some are related to acid inhibitions. These are the list of whole adverse events which can be there with PPI use. And this is drug interaction with clopidogrel, drug allergies, acute interstitial nephritis, chronic kidney disease, ischemic cardiac disease, cerebral ischemic disease, cholangitis, colitis, decreased life expectancy, and even dementia can occur. These events are unrelated to acid inhibition, and some of the events are related to acid inhibition, like iron deficiency, bone fractures, hepatic encephalopathy, even pneumonia, in colon cancer, gastric carcinoid tumor, and so many other adverse events related to acid inhibitions. So though these risk factors, associated risk factors, they have a very low level of evidence, even then the risk factor like hypomagnesemia and vitamin B12 deficiency can be checked annually in the patients low with the serum magnesium levels and vitamin B12 levels, either annually or at the 5 years interval. The adverse event like small intestine bacterial overgrowth, there is unclear clinical importance, and there is no recommendation to check for SIBO while using PPI. Other risk factors like bone fractures, Clostridium difficile infection, chronic kidney disease, and dementia, their association is really unclear and they have a very low level of evidence. So we need not to worry for these kind of associated risk factors, and very unlikely to have community acquired pneumonia. This has a very low level of evidence. So there are as such no recommendation for checking this in regularly in the patients treated with PPI. So this is a very recent article published in BMJ Open Gastroenterology to find out when does proton pump inhibitor treatment become long-term. In this review, this is a review article, a total of 742 studies were identified and only 59 met the eligibility criteria. And in a clinical context, the use of PPI for more than 8 weeks could be a reasonable definition for long-term use, while in other patients with dyspepsia, the use of 4 weeks can be a long-term use. And for research purposes, 6 months could be a possible definition in pharmacoepidemiological studies for a long-term use. So what guidelines has to say about long-term PPI usage? This is an Indian Society of Gastroenterology, GRD guidelines, that in the presence of erosive esophagitis, even after 8 weeks, the treatment may be required for a further of 4 to 8 weeks of PPI. And long-term maintenance therapy can be required for the prevention of relapses. But furthermore, long-term unnecessary treatment with PPI should be avoided. So the patients who require long-term medical management and proven GERD, they should be evaluated for another alternative treatments like surgery, maybe endoscopically or maybe open surgery for GERD. And this is the very important to evaluate and to assess the patient when to deprescribe PPIs in our clinical practice. And this is a clinical practice guidelines by Canadian family physician, where the recommendation is that every adult of more than 18 years who is having upper GI symptoms and who has completed a minimum of 4 week course of PPI treatment, the dose can be decreased. And we can stop the treatment if the patient is having a symptomatic relief, or alternatively, H2 receptor antagonist can be used as an alternative treatment, though have a weak recommendation and moderate quality of evidence also. So this is the algorithm for deprescribing PPI in any patient of GERD, whether we have to find out for what purpose the patient is having PPI. If the indication is unknown, then we have to reduce the dose. We can stop the PPI also in this patient, or on-demand PPI can be prescribed in such setting. And further, patient should be monitored for next 4 to 12 weeks. And if the symptoms are still there, then we can choose another alternative options like diet modifications or nighttime adding of H2 receptor antagonist, or weight loss can be beneficial for such kind of patients. And if the symptoms relapse and symptoms persist for more than 3 to 7 days, and these are interfering also in the normal activity, then it should be treated as H. pylori infection, and we should consider another options for these kind of these subgroup of the patient. So we should always evaluate the suitability of every patient before deprescribing the drug and for the long-term user PPI also. So when can we consider stopping the treatment with a PPI? We know that many of the patients who are taking PPI, they require long-term treatment, and the withdrawal of PPI may be inappropriate in such kind of patients, like patients with Barrett's esophagus also, and the patients who are having severe erosive esophagitis. Withdrawal of PPI should always be considered after consulting with gastroenterologist or any other specialist. However, in each practice population, there will be some patients for whom it is appropriate to reduce the dose of PPI from 20 milligram omeprazole once daily to 10 milligram omeprazole once daily, or it may be switched over to as needed dose of PPI. For the patients who are taking PPI for long term, the need of ongoing treatment should be consultation. So coming to the question that when can you consider stopping the treatment in some other group of patients, there is no clear evidence as to what the best regime for the withdrawal of the patient, but in general, downward dose titration should be thought of whenever the symptoms are under control For example, if a patient is using 20 milligram omeprazole, I have already told you that it can be reduced, and it can be reduced over 4 to 6 weeks to manage the symptoms of GERD. The patient responds to treatment and their symptoms resolve. The dose is then reduced to 10 milligram for next 2 weeks, and then treatment should be stopped in such patient. And if the patient is given a prescription of 20 milligram omeprazole, the as and when needed prescription can be given to these kind of patients. So the advice to the patients about the possibility of rebound as a secretion is really, really very important. It may happen after stopping the treatment or after reducing the treatment in approximately 40% of the patient. So the possibility should always be discussed with every patient before stopping or before reducing the doses, so that we can prepare the patient before withdrawing the drug. So there is a role of balance effect and positive adverse effect of long-term PPI usage. Definitely, we have to weigh the beneficial effect. And it is really, really beneficial in some of the patients, and the side effects are really on low side. So the patients can be benefited if they are selected properly and there is clear-cut indication. So the take-home message is that almost half of the patient, they require, they have a clear indication of PPI use, and nearly all adverse effects associated with PPI occur among patients who receive long-term therapy. Pharmacists definitely are in an ideal position to ensure appropriate and effective use and reduce PPI overuse. And clinicians can ensure that PPI use is associated with appropriate indications, utilizing the lowest effective dose for shortest duration possible through effective counseling. Thank you so much for patient listening.